No. After Austerlitz, I said I would have 6 more good years. And now it's 10 years and 9 campaigns later. Listening?
Every word.
After I'm dead and I'm gone, what do you think the world will say of me?
It will say you extended the limits of glory.
Is that all I'm going to leave my son? The limits of glory?
How can we say Napoleon was a great man? It seems intuitive to say that someone who started as a lower noble and ended up conquering all of Europe was a quote-unquote great man. But where do we get this evaluation from? What value system do we use? How can we evaluate anything if we do not use our classical moral value system? He certainly wasn't the most Christian man. He certainly didn't respect liberal morality and cared about human rights when he ravaged his armies against Spanish civilians and stomped down slave revolts. So why can we say that he was a great man if he doesn't fit into some metaphysics to evaluate him on? How can we say the same about Alexander the Great, Augustus, Diocletian, and many others? One man maybe has an answer to this question. Nietzsche is a philosopher appropriated by almost every political ideology, from anarchists to fascists. This is because Nietzsche wrote about so much in such a vague sense that 10 people can read him and have 10 different interpretations. This is most often shown by some edgy teenager picking up Das Buch Zarathustra, reading it and thinking that they now understand the system, which is Nietzsche. There's nothing wrong with doing that, of course. Reading should be done for whatever use someone gets out of it, and not to recover some absolute meaning from a text. This is what I want to make clear at the start of this video. This is not an establishment for another absolute interpretation of Nietzsche, but more offering a system, some sort of context of thought to put Nietzsche's ideas into. Die Gay Science, or better translated, the Joyful Science, offers a method, a tool for introspection, a method not only useful for philosophy, but also for the natural sciences, sociology, and of course, most importantly, politics. To understand why the Gay Science is useful, it is important to understand where it came from. It comes from a fundamentally important point in the history of philosophy, where classic metaphysics were in their last leg, and exactly this historic split is what this video is supposed to analyze. But to analyze the split in philosophy, we need to first of all understand what we are even analyzing. The problem of this video starts with the title already. What are metaphysics? Do I refer to Platonism, Christianity, idealism, nominalism? In the context of Nietzsche, none of these terms really mean anything. Nietzsche's greatest flaw is that he never actually points out any metaphysical theory that he refutes or finds problematic, because he doesn't care about that. Nietzsche is not an analytical philosopher who writes long formulas like Wittgenstein or Davidson about why metaphysical theories like Platonism and others have flaws. Nietzsche speaks about consequences and realities. The biggest criticism you can make against Nietzsche is that if metaphysical theories are correct, what he says doesn't become wrong, but trivial. If metaphysics have bad consequences in daily life, it's irrelevant for the factor if they are true or not. For example, even if every criticism against Christianity that Nietzsche makes are true, this would be irrelevant if the argumentation for God is correct. Christianity, in this case, wouldn't be correct because you like or dislike the consequences, but because the argument for God is sound and logically correct, and therefore the consequences should be followed, if you personally like them or not. But when we put Nietzsche in the context of Kant and Hegel, the reason for why Nietzsche didn't care for a deep theoretical refutation becomes obvious. It was overdone. Beating the early rationalists in classical metaphysics was like beating a dead horse. When we speak of the fall of metaphysics, we speak of classic metaphysics getting replaced by essential metaphysics like Hegel, and then the path towards nominalism. So Nietzsche is only useful to you if you have some theoretical basis to establish him on. For Nietzsche, metaphysics is never clearly stated, but many synonyms are implied in the idea of final causes. This final cause is most present when Nietzsche uses the phrase the death of God. The death of God does not specifically refer to the downfall of Christianity alone, but to the death of all final causes in classical metaphysics. Nietzsche criticizes metaphysics and how they are used as an escape in the systems of philosophers. Kant battled probably every philosopher in his time and very beautifully argued how their systems are flawed, but when you read all of Kant, you end up at the vague term of reason, which is Kant's last cause, something that can't be questioned. If you do the task and go through all of Hegel, at the end, you still end up in the Geist or spirit, which all of Hegel's theory are built around. This is fundamentally what Nietzsche criticizes. Nietzsche aspires the removal of all these last steps of philosophy. Accepting the final cause in a philosophy is not an achievement, it's quite the opposite. Kant's stopping at reason was not the final step towards a goal, but Kant's surrendering. And that is what Nietzsche wants to avoid. The tools he wants to use to avoid this trap that so many philosophers fall into is how he uses the term science and history, which leads us to the joyful science. As soon as the average esotericist hears the word science, he recoils, so obviously the people the gay science addresses the most will not watch this part of the video anyway. The gay science on Nietzsche is not an appeal to the natural sciences, quite the opposite. All the people who call themselves skeptics or hardened naturalists, like Richard Dawkins for example, are nothing more than a joke for Nietzsche.
An die Realisten, ihr nüchternen Menschen, die ihr euch gegen Leidenschaft und Fantasterei gewappnet fühlt und gern einen Stolz und einen Zierat aus eurer Lehre machen möchtet, ihr nennt euch Realisten und deutet an, so wie euch die Welt erscheine, so sei sie wirklich beschaffen. Vor euch allein stehe die Wirklichkeit entschleiert und ihr selber wäret vielleicht der beste Teil davon. Oh, ihr geliebten Bilder von Seis. Aber seid nicht auch ihr in eurem entschleiertsten Zustand noch höchst leidenschaftliche und dunkle Wesen, verglichen mit den Fischen, und immer noch einem verliebten Künstler allzu ähnlich?
The gay science for Nietzsche must be one that happens dominantly in the realm of philosophy, sociology and history. It must be a destructive force. The whole point of the gay science is to evaluate science differently. Science has a negative effect of being always evolving. Science requires no finite resource. Every question that is answered creates more questions, and every refutation of an answer does the same. The best example is when you look at the German term for science, which translates vaguely to Wissenschaft and can be literally translated to knowledgecraft. The problem with modern science, in Nietzsche's perspective, is that modern science is less about crafting new knowledge, but more about investigation, refutation, and simply rebuilding already established premises. Science is already a destructive force. This can be seen as a pessimistic thing. And this is why we need a joyful science.
Wahrheitssinn. Ich lobe mir eine jede Skepsis, auf welche mir erlaubt ist zu antworten. Versuchen wir es. Aber ich mag von allen Dingen und allen Fragen, welche das Experiment nicht zulassen, nichts mehr hören. Dies ist die Grenze meines Wahrheitssinnes, denn dort hat die Tapferkeit ihr Recht verloren.
So why should this depressive, destructive and never-ending act be joyful? Nietzsche answers to the nihilists who express sadness over this destructive science. The losing of all fundaments on the first thought sounds like a negative thing, but Nietzsche disagrees. The destruction of fundaments should be a joyful thing, even if it brings sorrow. For when it brings great sorrow, it can also bring great joy. The philosopher should not feel a sense of scientific objectivity towards this new science, but an almost hedonistic joy in this destruction. Historically, philosophers have always valued the good, similar to the true, and truisms were shown by their stability. This true stability can only be sustained by these metaphysics being unquestionable. A turning away from that can make the classic philosopher say, the science has been corrupted and turned evil. But for Nietzsche, this is not an autonomous decision. Why did humanity become evil? Because now it needs this joyful science. With the start of the Enlightenment, metaphysics has started to be reduced, redefined, and damaged, and most philosophers were aware of this process. The path of the destructive, evil, and chaotic gay science is not a decision, but a necessary jump from a sinking ship of the old philosophies. The gay science is less of a science in itself, but a mindset that Nietzsche advocates for. He doesn't deny that you require some logical systems, in some cases, but as always, just as a mean, never as an end. This leads Nietzsche to advocate for the philosophy of small things. If there is no overarching meaning to topics, then topics need to be evaluated in their smallest parts. Research should focus on deconstructing single topics, for example, an analysis of psychology, an analysis of violence, an analysis of conversations, instead of large, overarching, all-encompassing philosophies. But how can such a science operate? How can one form questions when not having a system or some context to get the ideas for the question? Well, if there is no metaphysical reason or ontology that forces us to go down the path of looking for truisms, then what's the point? Nietzsche solves the fall of metaphysics with an alternative system: history. Nietzsche has two different appliances and definitions of history. One is for the use of history for philosophy, and one is for the use of history for life. The use of history for philosophy is to offer a fake metaphysic, so to say. Not because it is absolute, but because it's the only thing we have. The fundamental behaviors of humanity are not determined by some logical absolute, but simply by looking at the patterns and regularity in history. Nietzsche, when looking at history, sees the fundamental behavior of humans in setting values, or in the more popular phrasing, will to power. Will to power sounds edgy, but is nothing more than setting values upon other people, and that is what living is in his definition. Setting values does not refer to some empty idea of just screaming into the void, but specifically about setting values on or in opposition to other. The person you set the value on is the weaker part in that relationship. Living means, and as edgy as this sounds, destroying the weak. People who just sit in a room and stare at the wall do not fall under the category of living for Nietzsche. But where does Nietzsche take this value statement? It is easy to just accept these phrases because they sound edgy and cool. There's a reason for this evaluation. If there are no metaphysics, and history is the only thing we can use for evaluation of what is fundamental for human behavior, then what is more of historical relevance sets values, not only in their current time, but also into the future way beyond their lifetime. For example, Caesar did not only set values upon the Roman Republic, but also sets values 2000 years into the future for anyone who reads upon the human past. The average Roman slave or farmer obviously acted in certain behaviors too, but there is not the Roman slave, but a Roman slave. They did not set historical values for themselves. Therefore, they are not part of a historical evaluation as an actor, but as an object, for example, the masses. When we evaluate Caesar, we do not analyze him as one or a Roman general, but as a conscious actor setting his ideals into the world. The same can't be said about the average slave. So if human behavior gets universalized by historical behavior, and humans can influence this universalization through setting values into history, then actions of historical relevance have higher values because they are more remembered in the future than trivial actions. Setting values does not end with your death. So what does this mean concretely? Humans change religions, ideologies, state systems, and weapons. But one thing that always stayed the same in history is that humans existed to secure their material conditions, and some wanted to expand on them. Or as Nietzsche would call the expression, will to power. All value judgments without metaphysics are therefore not judged by logos or moral systems, but upon their impact into history. It also offers an answer to when the average idiot says, "I don't want to expand my material conditions, I'm happy with what I have." These people can very much believe in this, but because we analyze for history and these people will be irrelevant and will have no impact, they don't exist in the long run and don't affect our analysis. These people will not be remembered as a person, but as a collective behavior inside of the masses. For example, when we read about Athenian democracy, there are political actors like Socrates and Themistocles, the people we actually remember the names of, and then the masses that act like a nameless collective force of nature. I'm not trying to disprove here that the masses are not important in history, but the average housewife saying that she doesn't want to expand her material conditions or some other dumb sentence is irrelevant. The masses will still do exactly that, no matter what trivialities the individual parts of it say. We can also use the French Revolution as an example. We can differentiate in that time between the rioting masses and then the people who appear out of this, like Robespierre and Napoleon. The term autonomy is a big word, but in the most basic sense of the word, great men have autonomy, the masses do not. And we can value these great men higher because they contributed to themselves into the structure or ontology or whatever you want to call this of history, which we then work with for our evaluation of politics and all human sciences. They universalize themselves. Nietzsche shows great respect for Napoleon. In the genealogy of morality, for Nietzsche, Western history is a gigantic battle between the values of Rome versus the values of Judea, which Rome obviously lost. Instead of not trying to cry and harp on this loss, Nietzsche accepts the necessity of Judea and then uses Napoleon as the person that defines the synthesis between the energy of ancient history while also incorporating Judea and creating a synthesis.
Wie ein letzter Fingerzeig zum anderen Wege erschien Napoleon, jener einzelnste und spätestgeborene Mensch, den es jemals gab, und in ihm das fleischgewordene Problem des vornehmen Ideals an sich. Man überlege wohl, was es für ein Problem ist, Napoleon, diese Synthesis von Unmensch und Übermensch.
Nietzsche's method on valuing actions through historical relevance is also best represented on Napoleon's final writings. Even though he lost, they aren't bitter. Because he knows, no matter how far Europe will progress, the historical and cultural impact of him will be massive. Napoleon set his values on history, and therefore on all of us.
Malgré toutes les calomnies, je n'ai aucune crainte quant à ma renommée. La postérité me rendra justice. La vérité sera connue, et le bien que j'ai fait sera comparé aux fautes que j'ai commises. Je ne suis pas inquiet du résultat. Si j'avais réussi, je serais mort avec la réputation du plus grand homme qui ait jamais existé. En l'état, bien que j'ai échoué, je serais considéré comme un homme extraordinaire. Mon élévation était sans précédent, car non accompagnée par le crime. J'ai mené 50 batailles rangées, dont j'ai presque toutes gagnées. J'ai élaboré et mis en œuvre un code de loi qui portera mon nom à la postérité la plus éloignée. Je me suis élevé de rien pour être le monarque le plus puissant du monde. L'Europe était à mes pieds. J'ai toujours été d'avis que la souveraineté résidait dans le peuple. En fait, le gouvernement impérial était une sorte de république. Appelé à sa tête par la voix de la nation, ma maxime était « La carrière est ouverte au talent sans distinction de naissance ou de fortune. » 3 mars 1817.
Die Geschichte wird nur von starken Persönlichkeiten ertragen, die Schwachen löscht sie vollends aus.
Nietzsche differentiates between the history as a new system for philosophical evaluation and the use of history for life. This does not mean that you can't take personal benefits out of what I said in the previous chapter, but that there is a difference between the small personal use and the more grandeur philosophical one. The history for life is more like a character study of how history can create certain archetypes, each with their up and downsides. If we realize the importance of history for philosophy, there will be, of course, people who research and use history for themselves. And the negative and positive sides of that is what will be analyzed. The Wars group Nietzsche calls out is the modern quote-unquote historian. The modern objective historian misunderstands his job. For Nietzsche, the only true historian is one who is a superior in his time, one who can look down upon his current time and then evaluate it and write it down. The modern historian is not that. he submits himself to the structure and politics of his own time and drags everything he writes down to his level, because only then he can understand it. The historical sciences, and I use this in the biggest quotes, in their submission, do not understand what they research. A 40-year-old red-lip professor cannot understand someone like Alexander the Great or Charlemagne. If now such a person tries to understand them, they do not raise themselves to the great man's level or do an objective research, but imagine their low existence in, for example, Charlemagne's circumstances. They did not research personalities, they just discovered circumstances and then imagined themselves into them, fundamentally dragging even the greatest personalities down to whatever current status quo a professor or a researcher is in. Loudly they espouse that single men can't carry history forward because they couldn't either. They pretend to be objective when they just force the lowest standard of their time on the highest standards of a previous time. The modern day historians would respond to this and say that it's not his weakness which forces him to this idea, but some idea of objectivity and historical facts. Based upon the average history department, this lack of introspection sounds like a smart statement to them. Documenting and evaluating historical actions cannot be done in a universal way, because there is no universal evaluation. Trying to force Caesar into neoliberal values will simply not work. The objective historian is a disgusting and hateful figure. There is no person you could find that despises the people of history more than him. But that is all that Nietzsche says to this, I wouldn't say stereotype, because I study history, trust me, these people are real. But let's get to the second character. The second character for Nietzsche is the antique human, someone who seeks themselves inside of history. The antique human looks at the history of his country, town or village and equalizes himself with it. Every passion of the village is a passion of his. The value of history for this being is that if he got created by such values, then the future generations should also be built upon such values. Because the antique human sees himself in history, he fundamentally misunderstands the history itself. For the antique humans, every historical event just exists to create him, and that is all that history is useful for him. History for such a being is not valued upon what is bad or what is good, because how can something that is not useful or bad be part of history if it created him? The antique human reduces his vision of history to only that which produced him, stopping him from ever going beyond that. Traditions don't get questions, and all the trivialities of history, like dances, clothing and beer, become the primary of his life and his historical view. But Nietzsche doesn't judge this use of history fully as negative, and uses the example of the Renaissance. The antique use of history can become greater than itself, if in the past there was something great which has been lost and is now recovered. The antique use of history can become a middle step of recovery. The evaluation of your past in refuting wrong steps you took and looking beyond your own history. The antique human can become good when his historical vision is not focused on trivialities but actual evaluation. Which leads to the most important use of history, the tool of great men.
Wodurch also nützt dem Gegenwärtigen die monumentalische Betrachtung der Vergangenheit, die Beschäftigung mit dem Klassischen und Seltenen früherer Zeiten? Er entnimmt daraus, dass das Große, das einmal da war, jedenfalls einmal möglich war und deshalb auch wohl wieder einmal möglich sein wird. Er geht mutiger seinen Gang.
For great men, as Nietzsche calls them, history is not something that is looked at for imitation, but reassurance. The great men, who live in times where nihilism and low spirits are the standard, the great men of such times can often fall into nihilism themselves and lose hope. They maybe think there is no alternative besides also becoming weak. Those great men look into history and see people who moved history forward as a reminder that things can be done. A reminder that if there is a possibility for good in the past, then there can also be another possibility of good in the future. For these people, history is not a science or a blueprint for reproduction, but a motivator to not give up. History is a philosophy of doing. It's a transcription of people who didn't just stare at a wall, but who went out, either succeeded or failed. In a time where you are more or less encouraged to always hear either encouragements of things that are equal to doing nothing, or to be discouraged of doing any real things at all, History is the refutation piece of such wars. The gay science in itself is only as important as the consequences it had for the rest of philosophy. The time of Nietzsche marks a fundamental break in philosophy, away from classic metaphysics. Reading the gay science and reading the post-structuralist wave like Foucault and Derrida is quite an interesting experience. Foucault himself could count as a straight-up continuation of Nietzsche's method. Instead of grand systems of metaphysics, he applied the gay science in researching genealogies and specific social topics. Same for Derrida. Derrida, in his commentary on Nietzsche in Spurs, marks how fundamental Nietzsche's method, or how he calls it, style, is. Nietzsche, on purpose, breaks the classic philosophical writing style and writes more direct, more emotionally, to represent the split. Nietzsche breaks the relational distance the reader has to the author. Nietzsche doesn't show you his system that you can now inspect from a distance. Nietzsche implicitly says that you are part of this discourse of the joyful or gay science, if you like it or not. The gay science is a fundament for most useful philosophy that came after it, and this shows itself in its political use. The gay science, as the ancestor to post-structuralism, offers a pragmatism that philosophy previously lacked, only really presented in people like maybe Machiavelli. The reason why I focus so much in history for this video is because if the gay science is applied to politics, history will be your primary tool of research. If you are more interested in this topic, Twist has an entire video dedicated towards that. In the end, the tools Nietzsche offers are based upon the premise that you have goals, that your systems of thoughts come from somewhere, and that you want to lead them somewhere else instead of escaping to last causes and vague esotericism that only makes you complacent and useless. And that is what I want to point out in this video, that your thoughts go somewhere and constantly go somewhere, that you don't just have an arbitrary absolute that you hold on to for no reason at all. If you want to take one message out of this, then that is the message. Either way, this video got way longer than I expected it to be, but that's how it always goes. I want to add a disclaimer. If I use some overly pretentious terminology, if I use some overly edgy phrases, that can be largely attributed to the material I have to work with in this video. There is nearly no way to make a video about Nietzsche and not sounding like an edgy 14-year-old atheist, but I tried keeping it to a minimum. So blame that to Nietzsche, not me. Also, another thing I want to add on is that what I offer with this channel is nothing more than methods, tools of thought, that any political ideology of the fringe can use for their goal. If you have a different ideology than me, that is fine, but remember that the methods and tools I offer can still be beneficial, and I hope you lead this method to something useful for whatever your goal is in politics. Anyway, thanks for watching, bye! They said I should've stayed dead, but the spotlight acquainted. They only like me 'cause I'm famous.